Perfect. Okay, well, welcome everybody who's joining us here on Zoom and everybody who's viewing on Facebook Live. Before we begin, we would like to acknowledge that Brampton Library is located on the treaty territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, and before them, the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, Huron, and Wendat. We also acknowledge the many First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and other global Indigenous people that now call Brampton their home. We are honored to live, work, and enjoy this land. So my name is Megan. My pronouns are she and her, and I'm a librarian with Brampton Library. I'm joined today by my colleague, Harmeen. Harmeen, if you just want to say hi.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for allowing me to join you today.
So Harmeen and I are going to just sit in the background and deal with the technical stuff of this program. And it's being presented, of course, by Parks Canada Learn to Camp, and I'll get to their introductions in just a little bit. But before I turn it over to them, I would like to welcome you to the second part of this Learn to Camp series, which is called Know Before You Go, Your First Frontcountry Camping Trip, or Camping 101. And this is, as I say, presented by Parks Canada's Learn to Camp team. And we will be meeting at the same time in the same place next week as well for Animal Aware, How to Camp with Wildlife Nearby. So feel free to visit our website, BramptonLibrary.ca, and register for that. It will be live streamed to Facebook then as well. And before we get into the meat and potatoes of this program, I'd like to remind everyone about our Brampton Library Summer Clubs. So you visit BramptonLibrary.ca and you can select Summer Clubs. There's a tab on the left-hand side of the top menu bar from our main page. We have programs for kids, for teens, for adults, with lots of activities and chances to win some great prizes over the summer. In-branch programming is still not being offered. However, I do want to let you know that four of our branches, Cyril, Clark, Four Corners, Chincoosie, and Springdale, are open for limited services, which actually now includes browsing. So you can go and browse our collection. Which is really exciting. That just started yesterday. But in-branch programming is still not being offered. We're all virtual right now. But we do have some offline activities for all age groups, such as escape box, virtual escape boxes for teens. We have the Then and Now photo challenge, which is running now for adults. And then next month, we'll have a newcomer self-directed city tour for adults as well. So, now I would like to get into introducing our presenters for today. First of all, we have Emily. Emily, would you like to just say hello?
Hi, everyone. My name is Emily.
Emily is excited to be a Learn to Camp team member of Rouge National Urban Park this summer. She is passionate about connecting people living in cities with outdoor experiences and promoting diversity in the outdoors. Emily was born in Shanghai, China, grew up in Calgary, Alberta, and worked previously at Banff National Park. She studies urban planning and development at the University of Toronto. In her spare time, she enjoys hiking, baking, and learning about gardening. And next we have Vanessa. Vanessa, would you like to say hello?
Hi, everyone.
So Vanessa is a student going into her fourth year in the Sustainable and Renewable Energy Engineering program at Carleton University in Ottawa. Due to COVID, she's back in her hometown of Pickering, Ontario, where she usually spends her free time biking, reading, and napping whenever she can. This is her first summer working on the Learn to Camp team at Rouge National Urban Park, and she's very excited to meet you all and talk to you about camping. So that's it from me. I'm really happy to pass it over to Emily and Vanessa to take you all through Camping 101.
Thanks, Megan. All right. So everyone can see my screen okay? Yeah? Okay, sounds good. And let's get started. So hello, bonjour, everyone. And welcome to our presentation. My name is Vanessa and I go by the pronouns she and they. And I work on the Learn to Camp team with Parks Canada. And I'm based out of Rouge National Urban Park, which is near the Greater Toronto Area. And I'm also here with my wonderful coworker, Emily, who who will briefly introduce themselves.
Hi, everyone. My name is Emily. Like I've said, I go by the pronouns she and her. I'll be helping out Vanessa with presentations today, putting some links in the chat, and then coming on at the end to help answer questions.
Thanks, Emily. So Parks Canada would first like to acknowledge that Rouge National Urban Park is built on the ancestral land of many nations, including the Anishinaabe, Anishinaabe, Huron-Wendat, and Mississaugas of the Credit. And at Rouge National Urban Park, we are very proud to be working with 10 First Nations through the First Nations Advisory Circle on the establishment, planning, and management of the park. And we work closely with the First Nations partners on a number of important projects, including archaeological fieldwork, restoration projects, and the development of visitor facilities. So since we're all on a video call and not actually in Rouge National Urban Park, we'd like to encourage you all to learn the history of the land in your area by exploring the nativeland.ca website. So Emily will send the link to that in the chat for you. So welcome to the Camping 101 presentation for new campers. So today you'll learn everything you need to know to plan and execute your first camping trip and to have fun doing it. So a quick introduction on Parks Canada's mandate. So on behalf of the people of Canada, we protect and present nationally significant examples of Canada's natural and cultural heritage, and we foster public understanding, appreciation, and enjoyment in ways that ensure the ecological and commemorative integrity of these places for present and future generations. So as part of the Learn to Camp team, we teach Canadians about the outdoors, how to camp, how to be safe, and how to keep animals safe. And we do this by presenting activities and workshops just like this one. And we also organize in-person workshops and events whenever possible to show people how to camp at our parks with all the equipment that you would need. So we provide opportunities for Canadians to learn outdoor skills and gain knowledge that will allow them to create memorable experiences. So with that in mind, we have a bit of a poll for this slide, because we'd like to know where everyone's joining us from today. Thanks. Yeah, so are you joining us from Toronto, somewhere in the Greater Toronto Area, somewhere else in Ontario, or outside of Ontario? So it looks like most of us are coming in from somewhere in the Greater Toronto Area. We have a few who are somewhere else in Ontario, someone in Toronto, and a few people from outside of Ontario. That's pretty cool. We've got lots of different locations that everyone's coming from today. All right. So just to get started, I'd like to begin by sharing my story of how I fell in love with camping. So one of the first few times that I went camping, I went to the Glen Rouge campground at the Rouge with my extended family. There were quite a few of us, and part of the reason why that experience was so meaningful to me was because I got the chance to spend time with so many of my family members who I didn't get to see very often. And this trip was also the first time that I got to try s'mores and the first time that I got to see deer in the wild. It was really exciting as a whole. So that trip really helped me start to love camping. So now I'd like to take a moment to ask all of you here today, what brought you here? What are you most interested in learning about camping? Do you have any questions that you really want to ask? So feel free to write your answers down in the chat box or to save them till the end of the presentation if you want. But remember that your answers for what brings you here today and why you want to go camping will help you in planning your first camping trip, because they'll narrow down your focus based on what you want to do and what you want to get out of your trip. Yeah, so we have a poll for this, and we'd like to know, what kind of activities are you looking forward to doing while camping? So are you looking forward to going hiking, boating, building a campfire, or going biking? So it looks like we have a bit of an even spread of people who want to go hiking, boating, and build a campfire. All great activities. Yeah, so a bit about our topics for today. So we'll talk a bit about camping basics first, then we'll get into how to plan your trip, what sorts of things to bring and how to pack them, then camp cooking, and lastly, wildlife safety. So first we'll talk about camping basics. So for some of you, camping might be something completely new. So what is camping and why should you try it? So camping is an outdoor recreational activity where participants leave their home areas and go out and enjoy nature while spending one or several nights outdoors, usually at a campsite. And while at a campsite, most people will sleep in a shelter such as a tent, a cabin, an RV, or a motorhome, and take part in outdoor activities during the day. So to accomplish this, participants can bring along a variety of items from home, which allow them to enjoy their time spent outdoors in relative comfort and safety. So during our presentation today, we'll be focusing on a specific type of camping that is often referred to as car camping or frontcountry camping. So this is the most popular form of camping, where you reserve a campsite that is situated within a larger campground. So this here is an image of one of our national campgrounds at Parks Canada at La Mauricie National Park in Quebec. So within frontcountry campgrounds like this, your reserved campsite will be one amongst many others. And on busy summer days, there will be dozens of other groups that are camping on sites nearby yours. So your campsite will be situated within sort of a camping loop, with other tents located on neighboring lots, just a few meters away from your own campsite. So you can sort of think of a campground as sort of a tent village that's filled with people who love sleeping outdoors and spending time in nature. As well, diagrams of frontcountry campgrounds show the locations of all of the campsites and lots of facilities, such as washrooms at the campground. So as you can see in the bottom left-hand corner, there's a very helpful legend that indicates how to find everything at the campsite. So that brings us to talking about the campsite specifically, which will be your home in the heart of nature. So this will be your personal space for the duration of your stay at the campground. So when you arrive, your campsite will mostly be a bare patch of ground, where you'll want to raise your tent, unpack your gear, and make yourself comfortable. And most campsites will have a picnic table and a fire pit already installed. So during your stay at a campground, what you choose to do and what activities to take part in are totally up to you. And as we talked about earlier, there are many, many things you can do. So you can do things like hiking, biking, boating, fishing, or you can do nothing and relax in your tent too. It depends, it's up to each person, and that's why each camping trip will look different depending on what activities you want to do, which is why it's pretty important to think ahead before you go and think about what activities you want to do when you're camping. So So that brings us to our next topic, which is trip planning. So trip planning can be pretty overwhelming. So that's why getting advice from people with experience camping is always super helpful. So I remember when I went camping on my own for the first time, I talked to many of my friends, family members, and even coworkers to help me with planning my trip. And as well, staff at stores where I bought camping equipment from also helped me with finding the right equipment that I needed. That's why building ourselves a network of people who camp can be a great way to share gear and to go on trips together. So the first question to ask when you're planning your trip is, why do you want to go camping? So I've already mentioned a few of my own reasons for wanting to go, but now it's time to consider your own. So feel free to take a moment to think about it. So what is it that draws you in about camping? Do you want to experience natural landscapes? Do you want to unplug, relax? Do you want to spend quality time with your friends and family? Do you want to go on adventures or have new experiences? So it's important to think about why you want to go, because these reasons why will help you with the rest of your planning process. To have adventures? Yeah. Getting closer to nature? Yeah, great reasons. Yeah, even I love having adventures, and yeah, having adventures specifically in nature, always super fun. Great reasons to go camping. But another reason to factor into your trip planning is, what is your budget? So this will be a key consideration because there are several costs that are associated with camping, such as fuel and transportation, so how you'll be getting to the campsite and getting back home, as well the equipment, so the gear and items that you'll need for your trip. As well, we have food and drink items, because you have to eat and you have to stay hydrated. And park entry fees, campground reservation costs, and firewood if you're planning on building a campfire. But if this is your first trip and you aren't yet convinced that camping is something that you're ready to invest in, there are many options for you to kind of mitigate your costs and avoid buying several things up front. So there are options for you to rent certain camping items like tents and other like camp cooking equipment, depending on what your needs are. So another question to ask in your trip planning process is, where do you want to go camping? So Canada is a really big country, but you don't have to go that far to find a great campsite. In fact, for your first experience, we recommend that you stick close to home, especially if you're planning on bringing your kids with you. So that way, if you need to leave for any reason, your home isn't too far away from you. So if you search the internet, you're most likely going to be able to find many suitable campgrounds within a 2-hour travel distance from where you are. Because there are many different types of campgrounds. So campgrounds in Canada typically fall into one of the following 3 categories. So there's private commercial campgrounds, provincial park campgrounds, and national parks campgrounds. So with so many options available, can be pretty daunting just trying to decide on where to go. So this is where getting advice from your friends, family, and coworkers can become very useful. Nothing beats first-hand experience, which is why it's important to ask around. As well, when you're deciding where to go, you can consider things like, how far do you want to travel? What types of activities do you want to do? What types of services do you prefer to have when you're camping? And what type of access to the campgrounds there is. So another factor to consider is, what type of services do campgrounds provide? This is because the available services and amenities will vary from campground to campground. So at Parks Canada locations, Frontcountry campgrounds all offer washrooms and may include showers, kitchen shelters, electrical outlets, drinking water, and Wi-Fi access zones. And campgrounds might also be in close proximity to other facilities like an outdoor theater, grocery stores, playgrounds, and even picnic shelters. So here's an example of the information that you can find when you're researching campsites on the Parks Canada Reservation System website. So as you can see here, they show the service type, what type of equipment you're allowed, how many people are allowed, how big the site is. There's a picnic table, if you can have a fire pit, or if you can have a campfire. There's Wi-Fi and cellular coverage, lots of different things. So another factor to consider is, when do you want to go camping? And for how long? So generally speaking, camping can be done at any time of the year. But if you're a new camper, we recommend booking your trip during the warmer weather months. So June, July, and August are popular times to go. So you can book campsites during weekdays, weekends, or a combination of both. So long weekends tend to be busier, and you might have trouble finding available spaces during these times, which is why it's a good idea to do your research and try to book in advance if you can. And once you have some experience, you might also want to try camping during the shoulder season, which is either late
Vanessa, I don't know if you can hear me, but you seem to have frozen. So I'm wondering if you might want to just turn your camera off to present.
I'll also like to plan.
Oh, there. I think you came back. You just froze for a bit there, Vanessa. Yeah, that's okay. If you're having connection issues, then maybe it might be a good idea to just turn off your camera. Sometimes that helps.
Yeah, I can definitely try that.
Okay, I'll let you know if it's an issue again, but you're back now.
Okay, that's good. Okay, if I end up freezing again, I'll turn my camera off, but I think for now I'll leave it on.
Sounds good.
Just feel free to let me know. Yeah, just stop me if I'm talking.
No problem.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah, so some other people like to plan their camping trips to coincide with natural events like meteor showers or annual bird or butterfly migrations too. So we have a poll for this slide. We'd like to know what's your favorite season to go camping? So do you prefer to go in summer when it's most typical and it's like hot outside and cooler at night? Or do you prefer to go during fall or spring or even in winter? So it looks like most of us here prefer to go camping during summer, and great choice. Camping in summer is always fun. We also have some folks who'd like to camp during fall and spring, also great times. And they're also pretty good times for avoiding bugs or avoiding really hot weather. So they tend to also be popular. Yeah, all great seasons. So yet another thing to consider in your trip planning process is who will be coming with you. So unless you're planning a solo trip, you'll want to involve your household in the trip planning process. So make sure to include them in decisions that you make along the way, find out what their expectations are and what activities they want to do during your camping vacation. Kids especially tend to feel a lot more excited about camping if they've been included in the planning process. So if you're planning on bringing kids on their first camping trip, we suggest having a trial run at home first. And if possible, practice putting up a tent and sleeping outside before your actual trip. So that way, kids will know what to expect, and if there are any potential obstacles, you'll know about them before you leave home. And also, knowing who is coming will help to guide you on what to pack to bring with you. Which brings us to our next point. What do you need to bring on your trip? So remember all of your answers to the previous questions, because they will help to guide you on what you need to pack with you. So everything you'll be bringing should be falling into one of the following categories. So shelter and bedding equipment, clothing, kitchen gear, personal health and hygiene items, items for your children or pets, and activity items as well. So in the comments box, we'll drop a link to our list of recommended camping items as well, so you can get a general sense of what sorts of things you should be thinking about bringing with you. So when you're deciding what to bring, the first things you need to consider are the items and equipment that will keep you comfortable, dry, and warm. So we'll begin with talking about the tent. So there are many different sorts of tents, and they come in all sorts of colors, shapes, and sizes. So when you're deciding on the size of the tent, you can think about the number of people, space you'll need, and what type of things you'd like to store in the tent with you. It's also important to remember that the advertised size of a tent is almost always too small, so it's best to aim for one or two person sizes up. So for instance, if you're going with four other people, so there's five of you in total, you should probably aim to get a tent that claims to fit six or seven people, just so you have a bit of extra room and just so you can be prepared in case you need some extra space. Another decision that you need to make is whether you're buying your tent new, used, or whether you're borrowing or renting your tent. So there are many factors that go into the price of a tent as well, depending on the fabric, depending on what its use is designed for. So if it's designed purely for use during the summer, what or how long it's supposed to last you. But no matter what your needs are, you'll be able to find a tent perfect for you at many different types of stores. So you can go to big box stores, specialty outdoor stores, secondhand shops, and even online groups that buy and sell items. So another factor to consider is, I believe we have another poll for this tent slide. So while I was talking about tents as though they are the only camping option, there are many different types of outdoor shelter options that you can use when you go camping. So you can use a cabin, an Otentic, which is a specific type of cabin that is available at Parks Canada locations. You can also use a yurt or an oasis, which are other types of options that are available at Parks Canada locations around Ontario and Canada. You can also use a motorhome, so something like an RV or a trailer. So it looks like the options that most people chose were cabins and motorhomes. So yeah, these are all the options here are other outdoor shelter options, and they're all valid. But cabins and motorhomes tend to be more popular than the other three options, which are more specific to Parks Canada locations. But moving on, we'll talk a bit about tent accessories. So some things to look out for when you're buying a tent. So no matter where or how you obtain your tent, it's always important to check that it's in good condition when you get it and before you go. So the majority of cheaper tents you'll find are designed only for use during the summer and won't really stand up in severe weather conditions. So if you know that you want to go camping during the shoulder season, so spring and fall, make sure that you look for a tent that is specifically designed for three-season use. So you can look for things and different amenities, such as the zippers, check the poles, pegs, and the rain fly before you go. And when you're looking for features on your tent that might be helpful, and look for things like, or also check the tarp footprint, which is something, it's like a tarp that goes underneath your floor, or on the base of your floor of your tent. And as well, you might want to look for some lights that you can hang outside your tent because it gets really dark at night at campgrounds. So another reason why you want to specifically check your tarp and check your flooring before you go is because the floor of your tent can be flimsy. And remember that when you're sleeping in a tent, the only thing that's really between you and the ground is the fabric of your tent. So it's important to try to choose a tent with a good strong floor if you can. And if you want, you can also reinforce the floor with a tarp, putting it underneath your tent, or by purchasing a tent footprint if there is one available for your selected model. And again, what a tent footprint is like a tarp that is specifically designed to fit the needs of your tent. So it's about the exact same shape as the bottom of your tent. But again, not every tent has one, but it is something to keep in mind if you're looking to buy a tent. Which brings us to our next topic, which is tent features. So some other things to look for when you're buying a tent are features such as doors, so like the opening of your tent, as well as vestibules, which is sort of like this flap here that is kind of like the garage of your tent where you can peg it down and you can store things underneath it like your shoes or your gear. And another feature to look for is whether your tent will be easy to set up. So if there are many components that have to be put in place or if it's more simple to put up. And as well, you can check whether it has pockets or other organizational features. So some tips about setting up your tent. So once you arrive at your campsite and you're looking for a spot to set up your tent, you'll want to look for a raised flat spot that is away from the fire pit and away from any place where water might pool up. And if possible, try to remove any rocks or debris that might make sleeping uncomfortable. And also, don't forget to look up above your tent. You'll want to avoid any spots beneath large branches that might break off during strong winds. Also, as much as possible, keep the zippers of your tent closed and keep bugs outside of your tent. So you can establish a rule that everyone removes their shoes before coming into the tent. So this prevents dirt and pebbles from entering. And it's also a good idea to sometimes bring a small portable broom and dustpan to sweep up just in case, just to make things a bit more clean. And you can keep the inside of your tent clean when you're sleeping. So if you decide to put a tarp underneath your tent, another thing to keep in mind is to make sure that it's folded so that it doesn't extend beyond the outside edge. So if your tarp extends too far, things like morning dew or rainwater might collect and pool underneath your tent. With that in mind, also remember to dry out your tent once you get home so you can prevent mold from forming. So the next item we'll talk about is sleeping bags. So like tents, sleeping bags come in a wide assortment of varieties. So there are many factors to take note of, but the most important thing to take note of is the temperature rating. So a sleeping bag's temperature rating tells you the lowest temperature that the bag is intended to keep the average person warm. So these ratings assume you're using a sleeping mat for insulation, and that you're wearing pajamas or a base layer of clothing inside the bag. So it's best to aim for a temperature rating that's a few degrees lower than the nighttime temperatures that you're expecting. So, but also, if you don't want to spend money on a warmer sleeping bag, you can also always bring blankets for extra warmth. Especially for front country camping, this is an easy and affordable solution, especially if you're camping in a larger group. So another thing to note is whether you want down or synthetic fabric for your camp, for your sleeping bag, and about that. So downfill sleeping bags tend to be lighter and more compact, but they're a bit more expensive and you can't get them wet. And on the other hand, synthetic sleeping bags are a bit more cheaper, can usually do the job, and they tend to be a more popular choice among first-time campers. And in terms of the price range, cheaper adult sleeping bags begin around $20, but factors like the quality, durability, weight, material, and warmth will all vary depending on the brand and the model and your budget. So another factor to consider is sleeping mats. So they are essential for keeping you warm during the night, and they prevent you from losing body heat to the ground. They add an extra layer of padding for your comfort. So there are many different types of sleeping mats. So one of these is foam mats, which tend to be inexpensive, but they don't compress and they need to be rolled up for storage. Another type is air mattresses, which are more common, but they are large and heavy, and they require a separate pump, and they might spring a leak, which is something you have to take note of and be aware of when you're using it. Another commonly used sleeping mat is inflatable insulated mats, which are the most expensive, but they can compact a lot more than other models. So they're not really necessary for beginners, but there's something you might want to invest in if you plan on camping more in the future. So as well, the warmth of a sleeping mat is indicated by its R value, which is a measure of a material's resistance to heat loss. So basically, the higher the R value, the greater the warmth. So an R value of 4 or less is okay for summer, but if you plan to camp during spring, fall, or in higher altitudes, then you might want to get something with an R value that's higher than 4. So now we'll move on and talk a bit about camp cooking. So this can be pretty important, especially if you don't really plan on eating your food cold. So you'll need to learn and plan how to cook and reheat your meals while camping. So there are many ways to cook while camping, but one common way is to use a camping stove. So car camping stoves are very easy to use and very familiar, since they replicate the experience of cooking in a kitchen, except outside. So another common choice is two burner stoves, which are the best choice for most car campers. So these accommodate standard kitchen pots, and they're great for making meals for groups. Then again, another thing to keep in mind if you're bringing any kind of camping stove is to make sure that you buy the right type of fuel for your stove and that you bring extra fuel when you're going. So moving on to a bit about camp cooking. So it's also one of the best parts of camping, depending on what you're doing. But just like the rest of your trip, it's important to have a plan. So think about how many days you'll be at the campground and who will be there with you. So you can consider what you'd like to eat for all your meals and what kind of snacks you'd like to bring. So if you need any inspiration, the internet is a great resource for finding recipes and new ideas. But that brings us to our poll for this question, which is, what's your favorite way to cook while camping? So there are many different types. We talked a bit about camp cooking over camping stoves, but you can also cook over a campfire or use a barbecue or a charcoal grill. So it looks like nearly everyone's favorite way to cook is over a barbecue, though we do have a few boats for over a campfire, as well as for charcoal grills and stoves. Really, they're all great options, although barbecues tend to be pretty popular, as well as camping stoves, just because camping stoves tend to be the easiest. So some meal ideas. So there are lots of different types of meals that you can make while camping, but we'll talk about a few ideas just to get you started. So for breakfast, you can make scrambled eggs. So if you're bringing a camping stove, you could just scramble an egg in the pan and it's pretty quick and easy. For lunch, you could make something like a sandwich or a wrap, which you can then customize to whatever your preferences are. They're pretty fast and easy, especially if you're planning on going away from your campsite. So they're pretty easy to also pack up if you're planning on going on a hike or something. As well for dinner, I personally like trying out meals that you can make at home that tend to be a bit more filling. So things like pasta or rice. And then for dessert, one classic is s'mores. But if you're feeling more adventurous, you could also try roasting a banana on the fire and adding chocolate chips to make a banana boat. And then for snacks, you can have lots of different things like trail mix, fruit, granola bars, and chips. But we'll send a link into the chat to give you some ideas about meal planning for your trip. So now I'd like to take a minute and ask everyone, does anyone have a favorite camping recipe or something that you want to try making while camping? So feel free to let us know in the chat. Really love to hear if you have any stories. Chili, yeah, that's a great one. Yeah, super filling. I haven't actually made chili while camping, but that must be like super filling, especially after a long day. And yeah, that must be like super nice to like come back to and just relax around the campsite. Someone wants to know when we'll be done. Great question. So we have a few more slides to go, but we'll finish up our section about camp cooking and then we'll talk a bit about wildlife safety. But again, if you have any questions, feel free to just keep asking them in the chat and we'll get to them at the end of our presentation. Yeah, so pasta, pesto, avocado, and walnuts. That sounds really delicious. Wow, that's like a pasta salad. Must be soup. Yeah, like a nice pasta salad too. Super filling. Yeah, so for chili, you make it up beforehand and just heat it up over the fire. Yeah, that's a great idea. Yeah. That's commonly what happens while camping. You plan and prep your meals beforehand. It also cuts down on your cooking time while you're at your campsite. So yeah, great idea. So we'll move on and talk a bit about some cooking tips. So again, whatever you decide to bring, one of the best suggestions that we can give you is to prepare as much as you can before leaving home. So the more that you do advance, the less that you'll have to do at your campsite. So doing some extra prep work at home in the comfort of your own kitchen will make your trip a lot more enjoyable. So some of the things you can do are to chop or marinate your vegetables at home. Can pre-cook your meats, and you can also bring instant add water dishes. So things like instant rice, instant noodles, oatmeal, and you can also bring lots of snacks to fill you up throughout the day. So a bit about campfires. So building a campfire is one of the most popular camping activities, and knowing how to build a campfire is a really great skill to have. You can cook over a campfire, as we talked about before. You can also roast marshmallows, stay warm, and overall, they're a lot of fun. So with the right tools and a little practice, you can get one going in no time. So we'll drop a link into the comments for you to see our How to Campfire video after the presentation. So this little video just helps you learn how to kind of set up a campfire and helps you prepare and know what to do in the event that you do want to build one. But again, before you actually start a campfire, there are a few things to consider. So number one, is there a fire pit? Number two, is there a fire ban in the area? And number three, do you need to purchase a fire permit? So in most national parks, you do need to purchase a fire permit to start a fire. So if you'd like to have a fire, the best thing to do is ask the staff at the park you're at before you arrive, or when you first arrive as well. So another thing to remember is to please do not bring outside firework into a national park. So this helps avoid introducing invasive species into the park. So for instance, if you live in Toronto and you're planning to go camping up in Thunder Bay, you can't bring firewood from Toronto to Thunder Bay, since you might unknowingly bring these little invasive species into the park. So a bit more about camping over or cooking over a campfire. So some tips to keep in mind if you are planning to do that are that you'll need something to grab your pots and pans with, also that you might not want to bring your best pots and pans because they might get a little dirty. As well, you might not even need a pot or a pan if you plan on bringing things like roasting sticks or aluminum foil. And in general, you should know that this is a little more rustic than using a camping stove. But overall, if you're planning to start a fire for any reason, it's important to know what rules are in place and to prepare about it before your trip. So now we're going to move on and talk a bit about wildlife safety. So one thing to keep in mind is that you really should keep a bare campsite to the best of your ability. And what that means is that you should keep your campsite as clean as possible. So while you're at your campsite, make sure to put any wildlife attractants, so things that smell or that have a scent, in your car or in your food locker or bear box when you're not using them. So this includes things like food, personal care products, dishes, garbage, anything that has a smell. So tents are not a safe place to store food, since animals can easily tear through a tent wall to find even the tiniest little bits of food. And when we're talking about animals, we're not necessarily talking about the large, dangerous mammals like bears or lynx, but actually things like raccoons and squirrels that are more common in some areas and are more used to being fed by humans. So it's important to remember that anything with a strong or delicious smelling odor will attract unwanted attention from animals and could lead to a dangerous encounter. And which is why it's important to keep food and scented items in your car at night or in a food locker if there is one at your campground. Again, it's very important to pack everything away and to never ever leave food unattended at your campsite. So leaving food out is serious because it'll attract animals, and that makes it dangerous for not just you, but the whole campground. So moving on to something lighter, we'll talk a bit about hiking. So when you go out into wild areas, you might want to try traveling in a group, since you'll be making more noise. So this is because if you're talking or shuffling your feet, this will alert any animals of your presence so you don't startle them. Especially if you're going around a corner, you might want to try shuffling your feet a bit more, or stomping, or clapping your hands, just so you can alert any animals of your presence. So when animals get startled and they don't realize or they're surprised by humans, that can scare them, and it can also lead to a dangerous encounter. Which is why it's important that even if you do encounter an animal, to always try to keep your distance as much as possible. So when you encounter wildlife, should always try to stay at least 100 meters away. So this will help ensure your safety and the animals. So if you see an animal, as well, keep your distance, but also look for clues that you might be getting too close to it. So you can note if there are any changes in its behavior, such as like raising its tail, moving its head. And so to remember how much distance we need to put between ourselves and wildlife, we came up with the thumb rule. So with the thumb rule, the first point is to stay 100 meters away from wildlife. So to measure this, we have a rule, which is that if you can stick out your thumb at an arm's length away and you can't completely cover the animal with your thumb, that means you're too close. So if you stick your arm straight out like this, and then you point your thumb out, like in the first picture, if you can't completely cover the animal with your thumb, that means that you need to back away. But in the second picture, you're far enough away that you can completely cover the animal with your thumb. So the thumb rule can also be applied to many situations, such as even if you're encountering animals on the road. So if you're driving by and you see wildlife, remember to first remain in your car. So this goes back again to the thumb rule. We always want to keep as much space between us and wildlife as possible. And also remember to please don't stop for bears and other large animals, even if they might be special or rare to you. So when we stop for wildlife, this can cause traffic accidents, and it can be dangerous for both humans and wildlife. So also remember that feeding wildlife is illegal, even if they are pretty cute. So that's why we ask that you help us keep the wild and wildlife by giving animals their space. This is actually one of Parks Canada's main objectives, because wildlife that become comfortable around humans pose a huge safety threat to both themselves and to people. So for more information about the Rouge or about Parks Canada in general, feel free to browse our website or check out our social media accounts or contact us by email or phone if you have any questions. But that brings us to the end of our presentation. So if there are any questions, we can definitely answer them now. So someone asked, where can we rent camping gear? Okay, yeah. So Emily said that, yeah, Mac and other specialty outdoor stores have rentals. Yeah. That is true. So another person asked what the best way to store meat while camping is. Yeah, so that's a great question. So I would say if you have a cooler, or if you're able to freeze your meats beforehand, that would be ideal, because then when you're going camping, you can't exactly bring your freezer with you. But if you have some other way to keep your food cold or to keep your meat cold, then that would be ideal, especially if you're planning to camp for more than a few days. So another person asked, how can you store dairy items during camping? So yeah, that it's pretty much similar to the way that you store meat while camping. So try to keep it as cool as possible, similar to fridge conditions. So if you have a cooler or an ice box, try to keep it nearby. Just try to keep it chilled if possible. And another person asked, how do you make sure animals don't get in the food you prep? That's a great question. So one thing you can do is try to keep your area as clean as possible when you're prepping food. So try to keep your area clean, like don't leave any like food or any scented items around so that animals will kind of not be attracted to your site for like as short a time as possible. So while you're eating, of course, you have to have your food with you, but try to be clean and neat about it if you can. And you can also use things like mosquito nets or bug zappers or bug spray to keep little insects away. Emily, did you have any other things to add about that?
Yeah, I think that basically really covers it. Animals, when you're food prepping, the animals I'm thinking about are kind of like birds that might come to the table. But if there's like a lot of activity around, I think they will kind of stay away from the food you're prepping. And if you keep the food covered, then there's less of a chance that they will be coming over.
Yeah, that's definitely true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. And maybe like only taking out what you're immediately using and then storing everything else away inside a container or your cooler. So we don't have like the whole feast on the table at the same time. I think we got a question about safety around dusk and dawn when camping. So when it's like dark in the campground.
Okay, yeah, that's a great point. So I would say around dusk and dawn, yeah, well, it's like dark outside. It's always a great idea to bring some sort of light source with you so that even if it is a bit dark, you can still see. So bring like a flashlight or maybe like your phone or anything that can light up so that you have some visibility. And depending on how comfortable you are, you can also try to travel in pairs. So like use the buddy system just so someone knows where you're going at all times.
Mm-hmm. Also like there's probably no like overhead lights, like road lights like we have in the city, and sometimes the ground is uneven, so look out beneath where you're stepping to make sure that you're not tripping or accidentally stepping on a creature or something. What about when you use the washroom in the middle of the night? Yeah.
Yeah, that's like similar to like when you go outside at dusk. So like try to maybe make some noise, like try to, and of course, like don't try to like wake up any other people who are camping and trying to sleep. But maybe if like there are little animals around who are used to just going about their day in the middle of the night without being disturbed by humans, just try to let them know that you're walking, and also, of course, bring a light with you so that you can see where you're going.
And I'll just add that if this is something that you are nervous about, when you're making a campsite reservation, you can see the distance that your campsite is from the washroom. So if you get a chance to, you might want to pick one that is closer to the washroom facilities.
Well, that was wonderful. Thank you. I think that's all the questions in the chat. I don't see anything else. If I've missed anything, just let me know, folks. You can just go ahead and put it in the chat again. But I think that's everything. So I just want to give you, Emily and Vanessa, a big, big thank you again for your time and for your knowledge and sharing this. I hope there's still so much of the summer left. So hopefully there is an opportunity for everybody to take what they learned and book a campsite maybe in the next coming weeks or next couple of months even. Because I know we said June, July, and August, but September, as long as people aren't back in school, or you can still go on the weekend, that still can be quite warm for camping as well. And I remember hearing that in the later summer, so early September, August, lakes tend to be warmer as well because they've been heating up all season. Is that true? Yeah, so if swimming is your thing, although we had a lot of questions about food, so I think eating might be the thing that people are looking most forward to. Anyway, that's something to take note as well. There's still time. All right, thanks so much. And for those of you who are interested in next week, it's Animal Aware, same time, same place. Please feel free to register on BramptonLibrary.ca to join us on Zoom, or we will be live streaming to Brampton Library's Facebook page again. All right. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having us.
Bye, everyone.